Welcome. My name is Geneviève Zubrzycki. I'm director of the Wiser Center for Europe and Eurasia. And today I'm very pleased to welcome you to this Wiser Center for Emerging Democracies event, which is also co-sponsored by the Center for Russia, East European, and Eurasian Studies. Before I introduce our distinguished speaker, I'd like to remind everyone to silence their cell phones, please. Thank you. And now that is operation is completed, let me say a few words about Natalie Jaresko. Natalie Jaresko began her career in public service in the United States, serving in the State Department from 1989 to 1992, and then as economic section chief of the U.S. Embassy in Ukraine from 1992 to 1995. So at a crucial moment in the history of Ukraine, after the recovery of national independence and the transition to democracy and market economy. For the next two decades, she worked to create a platform for private equity investment in the region, working as a co-founder and CEO of Horizon Capital, a fund with over $600 million under management, and as a president also and CEO of Western NIS Enterprise Fund. Given the significance of her public service, both in the US and in Ukraine, and given also her rich experience and expertise in the private industry, Ms. Jaresko was uniquely qualified to serve as Ukraine's Minister of Finance, a post she held from 2014 to 2016. She fulfilled that important function during a very consequential period when Ukraine was undergoing a deep recession on the one hand and a violent war on some sections of its territory on the other. She faced both storms brilliantly. During her tenure as finance minister, Minister Jaresko led the successful negotiation of the largest IMF program in the institution's history, as well as a complex debt restructuring. Her government's success in restoring macroeconomic stability enabled the creation of a broad international financial coalition to support Ukraine's democratic transition. She also led the reduction of public spending, cutting the deficit by more than 75% to 2.1% of the GDP in 2015. And since I stumbled on those words, I want to repeat them. She cut the deficit by more than 75% to 2.1% of the GDP in 2015. Finally, she advanced tax reform by cutting by nearly half the reduction in payroll tax, eliminating tax privileges which favored vested interests, implementing a transparent e-data system, placing all treasury transactions online in real time, and by initiating corporate governance reform in state-owned banks. So we're very privileged to have her with us today, as no one is better placed to talk to us about the next stage of transition for Ukraine than she is. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Natalie Jaresko.
Thank you very much.
Dear friends, thank you, special thanks to the Wiser Center for Emerging Democracies at University of Michigan for inviting me here today to discuss Ukraine and our next stage of transition. Almost 3 years in November, it will be 3 years that have passed since the start of Ukraine's revolution of dignity. What's happened since then? How successful has Ukraine been in transitioning and transforming itself into a country based on democracy, rule of law, one that satisfies the aspirations of the Ukrainian people to live in a country built on European values of dignity and freedom, political, social, economic rights that are truly inalienable rights. Where did we start? To understand the transition that's happening in Ukraine today, one must fully understand the situation at the time I was asked to serve. The country was in the midst of a set of crises which some believed foretold the end of the independent Ukrainian state. Some described it as an existential crisis. We had been attacked by the largest standing army in Europe. 7% of our territory had been illegally annexed or occupied by the Kremlin's forces, including Crimea and Donbas. The territory represented 20% of our GDP. The Crimean Tatars, who are the indigenous people of Crimea, were for the second time in a century being pushed from their native homeland. And the numbers of internally displaced people fleeing these wars grew with each day, reaching almost 2 million today, which was a challenge to our social, education, our health systems, even beyond the normal challenges of transition from a post-Soviet state. The recession, which in essence began in 2009 after the Lehman crisis, worsened with the loss of traditional trade, transit ties that were shut down by the Kremlin as just one more tool in its hybrid war. We were still reeling from the corruption and the mismanagement of the previous Yanukovych-led regime, which fled only after the Revolution of Dignity, or Maidan, during which over 100 citizens gave their lives for Ukraine's free European future. The economy was in a free fall. Less than 1 month's import coverage of hard currency left in our central bank, which meant not enough to buy gas for the full winter. The majority of the banking system was in dire straits, insolvent. Our currency was fluctuating widely day to day between 20 and 40 to the dollar. It was estimated that we had a $40 billion balance of payments gap over the next 4 years. How are we going to fill that? Where to find $40 billion? And finally, perhaps most critically, the social contract between the state and the people of Ukraine had been massively damaged by the actions of the previous Yanukovych regime, calling into question if any of the institutions of governance were really serving the interests of the Ukrainian people. Think back to the time during the revolution. The president turned his back on the European aspirations of his people. The Berkut, or the police, attacked sleeping students in the middle of the night. The courts arrested people from hospital beds. The police shot down unarmed protesters. The parliament adopted legislation limiting civil liberties. This was all during the revolution, each and every institution of governance proving it was not serving the interests of the Ukrainian people. And that social contract was very, very damaged. In the midst of perhaps the most difficult circumstances in European history, Ukraine had to not only fight for its existence, but we had to put ourselves back onto a healthy track. And I can firmly state that we have accomplished a great deal in these 3 years. More, in fact, than any other country has done in such dire circumstances and against such incredible odds. I'll go through a few of them with you, just key areas. First, we renewed our democracy with elections at every level, presidential, parliamentary, local government, and that began the task of rebuilding that social contract that I described to you that had been so destroyed. It gave people belief that they were electing their own representative officials. It gave society an opportunity to choose its leaders and rebuild its democracy. The second area, we've developed a very vibrant, active, demanding civil society that not only acts as a check and balance on the system, but it often acts as an initiator of changes, proposing changes, forcing changes, working with the international community to make these changes conditional in some of the loan agreements. This civil society is acting in a way today not dissimilar from Solidarność in Poland back in the 80s. Not as united as Solidarność was, one solid organization, much more fragmented, but still critically important. And it's very important to note that this civil society did not act in this fashion after the so-called Orange Revolution. After the Orange Revolution, for the most part, people went home and left it to the leadership to change the country. And with these kinds of changes, leadership alone is not enough. And so this is a remarkable difference from previous times in Ukraine's history. This civil society is strong, and it's focused on ensuring that the will of the people at Maidan is fulfilled. The third area that we've accomplished during this time, we've restored macroeconomic stability, and we've achieved a moderate level of economic growth, avoiding total collapse, which is what was predicted by naysayers when I entered into government in late 2014. We turned the government, the country around from having a loss of GDP or decline in GDP in 2009 of 15%, 2014, 10%. Try to imagine politics in this country with a decline in GDP of 15% 1 year, 10% 5 years later. You can't even imagine it. And we turned it around such that this year we're seeing growth of 2%. And that was done through fiscal policy, things, some of the things that were mentioned, tax policy, tax collections. It was also done by reducing expenditures. The point is that the country had no choice, and it had to take some very, very difficult decisions, but those decisions were the right decisions, and the results of stability are visible. The problem with stability, as you all know, is stability doesn't create necessarily new jobs. It saves existing jobs. Stability in and of itself doesn't create increased purchasing power, consumer purchasing power. So of course, the people want more. But you can't get to the next stage until you get to this one. You can't get there from minus 10%. You have to start growing again. The fourth area that we accomplished during this time is rebuilding and restoring our military after years of decimation and destruction. You can't imagine, but when we were attacked by little green men, in quotes, in Crimea, our military was unable to respond. First, the command and control structure had to be restored post-revolution. We had a temporary president. Second, the leadership from the previous regime had basically decimated both the core of the military, but also the weaponry. Ukraine is a major arms exporter historically. And to not have quality weapons of our own, God has spoken. To not have quality weapons of our own in our own military could only be done in a purposeful way. And so in a very short period of time, we were able to rebuild that military. We stopped the aggressor in his tracks, and we were able to push him back. We've recovered 60% of the territory that was occupied at some point during the war in the East, in Donbas. We did this with the help of our transatlantic partners, the United States, the European Union, Japan, Canada. We maintained sanctions, which is an absolutely critical part of this. Maintaining those sanctions kept the Kremlin at the negotiating table all of this time, giving us the potential to work through this in a diplomatic fashion and restore peace, most importantly, restore the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the country. Fifth, and many people don't recognize it, but we've eliminated our dependency on our northern neighbor for natural gas. We used to import our gas from one single source, the Russian Federation, Gazprom. For the past year, we have not imported any gas from the Russian Federation, any. Now, how did we do that? There's not one thing that we did that enabled that. It's a series of very, very serious reforms in the energy sector, starting with our own oil and gas company, Naftohaz, as it's called, the state oil and gas company, becoming transparent, having audits, developing a corporate governance structure with independent board members, adopting legislation about the natural gas market that puts it in line with the EU Energy Charter, and very, very difficult and painful step, but raising domestic residential prices for gas to import parity over 2 years. Our government took one step, and the next government took the final step. Raising those prices enabled us to stop subsidizing the state-owned company and instead subsidize those who were in need. Raising those prices to the same price as industrial gas enabled us to eliminate the rent-seeking activity that was going on in the market. People lying and saying they were buying it for residential purposes when in fact we were subsidizing their industry. Having one price in the marketplace has eliminated all of that. It's reduced gas usage. We haven't had to import as much. But more importantly, probably from the perspective of being able to have more flexibility in purchasing, we were able with these changes to get our international neighbors, our friends, our partners, to lend us $1 billion to purchase gas. three different credit lines, one from the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, one from the World Bank, and another from the IFC. Why is it important to have that ability, that revolving credit line available? Well, you can buy gas off-season. Off-season, the price is lower, so you immediately save money. More importantly, if you're buying it during the course of the year, you can use the reverse flow that we have available to us from Slovakia and Poland, which has limited capacity. But if you're not trying to do it all in the middle of winter, you can maximize the use of that reverse flow from Europe, store it in the massive underground storage tanks that Ukraine has, the largest underground gas storage tanks in all of Europe, and not have to buy from the Russian Federation. So we save money, we import less gas, we do it during the course of the year, we have a stable source of financing, all because of the recognition of the reforms that took place around the structure, the transparency, the management of that state oil and gas company. I'll come back to another element of that reform later. These changes changed a company that in 2014 ran the equivalent of $1 billion deficit, which the state had to finance. It was part of our deficit, to a company that is today in 2016 break even and possibly will show profitability this year. That is, for Ukraine, first time in history. So I'm giving you just these six general areas. We'll have time for Q&A. We can talk about other things individually. But this has been the longest and most successful reform process Ukraine has experienced in 25 years. Lasted 3 years, two governments, three IMF tranches, historic. We've never been in an IMF program more than two tranches. We usually make promises, get the first tranche, do something, get the second potentially, and then the third one is way out there. That didn't happen. We continue to be in the program, continue to fulfill our commitments. Yet, with all that said, there is still so much to do. And one of the key areas of effort remains putting an end to corruption, which is the most dangerous poison in Ukrainian society. We've transformed state-owned communism to a market. We've transformed a Soviet state of fear, lack of civil rights, to a vibrant civil society with freedom of religion, tolerance for religious and ethnic differences, lingual differences, freedom of media, assembly. We have the markets, we have the civil society. What's left? Rule of law. Rule of law. Rule of law will assure us that that market has a level playing field. Rule of law will assure us that in that market, contracts can be enforced in a regular, dependable way. Rule of law will ensure that that's a competitive market, not a monopoly market, by 10, 12, 14 different interests. Rule of law will assure us that civil society feels safe in its freedom to speak, to criticize, to make demands. And we've begun what is the most difficult, the longest battle against the vested interests that are stopping rule of law. In the 25 years that they've had to manage this transition, please remember that this transition is different from Eastern Europe's. In Eastern Europe, in particular in Poland, in Czechoslovakia at the time, in Hungary, they went from communism to being pulled directly into the EU and the EU system of rule of law. Ukraine went from communism to something else, and now we're trying to, through our EU deep and comprehensive free trade agreement and association agreement, move to some EU rules, but membership isn't a part of that agreement. It doesn't have the same draw. It doesn't have the same requirements. And so we had 25 years, 23 years, let's say, where something else, a different system developed. I call it a system of state capture. It's not about 10 oligarchs. It's about a variety of vested interests who have defined their vested interests in a way where public policy, specific tax rates, specific loopholes in taxes, specific subsidies, specific regulatory environments are created to enable those vested interests to monopolize a market or to reap rent-seeking type of profits from a market. So what have we done since the revolution of dignity, which was clear to everyone, the marker, the line drawn by Ukrainian society that enough was enough with corruption. Well, it's a four-pronged strategy, I would call it. First, we've tackled vested interests by eliminating many of them, eliminating these specific privileges and preferences that they had, their specific corruption schemes. We've implemented a series of things. We've saved several billion dollars. The estimate is about $5 billion a year in this method. One, I'll go back to oil and gas. For 23 years, there was an intermediary between the seller of gas, Russian Gazprom, and the buyer of gas, Ukraine's Naftogaz. There was an intermediary company that reaped billions of dollars, billions and billions of dollars over the 23 years. By marking it up, selling it to the state, and the state having to then repay or incur more debt. Some of those people, one of them is a former prime minister sitting in, I think, jail still in California for money laundering. Others are elsewhere. But the point is for over a year now, I think almost two, we've had no intermediaries in our gas trade. That privilege, that cash flow has been cut off. The same kind of thing we've done in the tax area. We've done it, for example, with a specific VAT special regime that agriculture had. And this VAT regime was supposed to support agriculture, one of the most, if not the most important sector of Ukraine's economy. But it was actually being used by about 3 to 5 of the largest agricultural firms. It wasn't supporting small farmers. It wasn't supporting targeted areas where you'd want to increase production or improve efficiency of production. It was targeted and being received, the bulk of it, by 3 to 5 firms. Over 2 years, we've transitioned away from that loophole or that privilege. But again, don't forget, that means we've cut off someone's privileges. We introduced an electronic VAT system. VAT is the European value-added tax. They have it instead of sales tax, basically. And we put an end to fraudulent claims for refunds. Fraudulent claims were coming in. Fraudulent claims were being refunded. And real claims, we never had enough money to refund. And that was possible because we couldn't tell the difference in the system between the fraudulent claims and the real. Now with this electronic VAT system, which is getting better and better with time, we actually can root out those who put this refund claim in with never having paid it in the first place. That eliminated probably $1 billion a year of somebody's cash flow. We started to systematically audit the state-owned enterprises. We still have some state-owned enterprises, not as many as we had 25 years ago, but there's still about 1,000 left, 300 of which are probably profitable, the rest are not. And they serve as have served in the past as very untransparent sources of vested interests making money. By insisting that they're audited, by showing how at our oil and gas company we can change to an independent board structure and corporate governance that's transparent, we've started a process that will start to eliminate, and by shining a light on these companies and transparency, a lot of those vested interests. There are numerous things like this. I talked about a small one today in another meeting, just raising the royalty rate for ammonia transit through the country. Hadn't been raised probably, I don't know, 10, 15 years. It benefited one particular business group. It's not corruption, but their influence on the state enabled them to have much lower royalties than they should have had. So by raising that, we stopped giving them an implicit subsidy. The second way to fight corruption, the second way we fight these vested interests, is eliminating the space for them to exist in the economy. That has to do with transparency. So that electronic VAT system is one way. A second way would be the e-procurement system, which is called Prozoro. We've moved slowly. First the central government, now the local governments, the state-owned enterprises have to use an electronic tender system. It doesn't eliminate all of the corruption, but again, it shines a light on all of the purchasing process. It eliminates a lot of the related party transactions. It's constantly, Ukrainians are very entrepreneurial. They're constantly finding ways perhaps to still maintain some kind of unfair advantage. But with each set of tenders, we learn more about what happens and we continue to improve it. There have been billions of hryvnias of savings just this year in the budget. And it's more than just vested interests. It's also, it gives civil society information to actually influence policy. So I mentioned somebody was buying a very luxury car, put out a tender for this luxury car purchase at a state-owned enterprise. And civil society rose up and said, no, you know, we're at war. You can't be buying luxury cars. And that tender was canceled. There was just too much pressure. So it helps not only with vested interests, it also helps, because of the transparency, to shine a light on what policies are actually being implemented. We've given open access to state property registers. You can look up my name, the president's name, anybody's name, and you can find out whatever property is registered under his name, his wife's name. It's a very, very open system. We've implemented eData, which is the treasury of the country, online in real time. My European colleagues said they'd never seen anything like it in anywhere in Europe. Again, it has two effects. One, civil society has the tools and the information. They can do the analysis of how monies are being spent, whether that's how they should be spent. They can give feedback as to whether or not they agree or disagree. But it also, in a sense, because it's so transparent, serves as a deterrent to do things wrong. People don't want to be put out there and in front of everyone, so they're doing less of it, slowly but surely. And finally, you must have read about this, it's been in every newspaper in the world, we have the e-declaration system. What is the e-declaration? Well, Ukraine committed to fulfill 144 different conditions in order to receive EU visa-free status for our citizens. One of those 144 conditions, which we implemented fully, was to introduce an electronic declaration system for all government officials. That means executive, legislative, as well as judicial, to a certain level, including local governments. And that declaration was not just your income, but all your wealth, your family's wealth. And there are two parts of it that are unique. One is it's fully, completely public. Now, you can't even imagine in the United States, one candidate doesn't want to show his taxes, another one, you know, and this is the greatest democracy on earth. All your wealth, anything over, I think it's $2,000 in value, every watch, every pair of earrings, whatever you've purchased with your money, Strauss shoes, I don't know what people own, everything, cash, any property, companies. And it's deeper, broader, and public than anything in this country or anywhere else. The deadline was October 30th. And with very few, handful of exceptions, a couple of who fled the country about 2 years ago, and a couple that were in the hospital, everyone filled it out. Now, I can't tell you how honest they filled it out or not. Some people say they might have written down 50% of what they really had. Some people say they would have they wrote down 150% of what they had so they'd have space to collect some more. I don't know. But the fact of the matter is, they're all available online for all of the citizens of this country to see. Ukraine committed to it. It did it, as painful and difficult as it is. And today, I would argue that it starts a whole new dialogue between society and government officials. Never again will someone be going to the polling booth not knowing who these people are. They know now more than they probably wanted to know about these people. It also divides up people who have accumulated great wealth from those who have not. The focus in most of the newspaper articles is on those who've accumulated enormous amounts of wealth. But there are dozens of people who haven't. And I think over time, they're going to get quite a bit of attention as well. Because they, as public servants, haven't done what maybe others have. Of course, the future of these electronic declarations all depends on how they will be then investigated, who will be investigated, and what will happen after an investigation is completed. And that brings us to the third path for Ukraine to eliminate vested interests. We had to create new institutions. The old former Soviet prosecutor's office, the old former Soviet prosecution approaches were insufficient and incapable of making a real change. So we had to establish a new anti-corruption office in our prosecutor's office. We had to establish, like in Romania, a national anti-corruption bureau that's responsible for looking into corruption, investigating corruption in any existing official, again, all three branches of government. We have a National Anti-Corruption Agency whose specific job it is to look at these declarations of wealth and look at your lifestyle and say, you were making $200 a month and you have three Maseratis. Doesn't appear to be rational. So there are these new institutions, all funded at Western salary levels. That was part of the conditionality of the international community that went with the loans that we had received earlier. And now dozens of investigations at all different levels of society have begun in Ukraine, from university deans to doctors to local government officials to hospital directors to deputy ministers to oblast administrators, you name it, deputies in parliament, judges included. The last major new structure that we created over the last year and a half, I have to mention, is the National Police Force. We take for granted in the United States we have a police force that protects and serves our interests. That wasn't the case in Ukraine. You could be very quickly stopped and asked for a bribe on the street by the traffic police. You could call the police in the case of a domestic violence, and they might not show up, or if they showed up, they might take sides. You didn't know what to expect. With the support of the United States taxpayers, Canadian and Japanese, we basically recreated our National Police Force, established higher salaries, an absolutely new training program. Everyone had to reapply. Less than 30% of the people actually came back into the new National Police Force. And we finally have, in I think 30 cities already in Ukraine, rolled out a public institution that serves the interests of the Ukrainian people. But these things took time. It took over a year to do that. The fourth area, and the fourth area is the most critical, is the judicial system. Because we can identify where the corruption is, we can prosecute, investigate, prosecute, but in the end, this is a democracy, we need to take it to a court. And a court needs to make a judgment. Is it legal? Is it illegal? And what will be the consequences of that action? I wish we had started this 25, 26 years ago, but we didn't. And so what we have now is at least begun this process. Constitutional reform came into effect October 1st, and the changes are dramatic. It's a long three-year process, but some of the changes are effective today. One that's critical is the judges have lost their immunity. You don't have to go to the parliament and ask for their immunity to be removed so that you can arrest them. And because you can imagine what would happen typically. You'd go to the parliament to ask for their immunity to be removed, and they were gone. That's no longer the case. Since October 1st, judges have already been arrested. The second part of it was to shrink the court system from four different levels, which had unending appeals, to three. And then it's something not dissimilar from what I described in the police system. All 8,000 judges have to go through an assessment. They have to meet certain academic, but not only academic, standards to stay judges in Ukraine over the next 3 years. And, as I said earlier, they also have to fill out these declarations of wealth and prove that they're not corrupt on their salaries. So what are the critical impediments to our success at this point? Well, you know, we're at a critical juncture in our history, and there's so much more work to do. It's not yet irreversible. To be irreversible, we need the rule of law. And we're facing three primary challenges. First, fatigue. Second, populism. And third, these vested interests. They're fighting back. You could expect that. And the success of these reforms themselves over the past 3 years has caused fatigue in the population because we've delivered massive macroeconomic change. It was extremely important to close 80 of the 180 banks that were insolvent, that were abusing the depositors' monies for the owners' personal and professional needs. But it was painful for the people who had their money in those 80 banks. They had part of it guaranteed, like we have in the United States, but perhaps not all of it. They had it guaranteed in local Ukrainian currency, our currency, and perhaps it devalued while before they got their guaranteed monies back. It was a painful process. Raising gas tariffs, I told you the value of that, the direct value in reducing usage, the indirect value of reducing the corruption, the value of being able to convince the international community to lend us money, and we've eliminated our dependence on the Russian Federation for gas, incredibly important reform. But when you get a bill that's seven times higher than it was last year, that's not the first thing you think about. Now, we put a subsidy program in place, but not everybody's taking the subsidies. They can get subsidies if they have a need, a financial need. My point is that the people of Ukraine are tired. And it didn't start 2 years ago. It started 25 years ago. So although I'd like to measure time from the Revolution of Dignity, that's not the case. Think back to how many devaluations the people of Ukraine have lived through, starting with the collapse of the ruble and all their savings becoming meaningless at independence. 1994, hyperinflation. 1998, the Russian financial crisis, another devaluation. And then another devaluation in 2009, and then another one in 2015. If that had happened to anyone in this audience, you'd be tired of it too. They have the right to be tired. That said, the reformers themselves are often tired. You fight, and sometimes you get tired. And the populace, the second part of this equation, take advantage of this fatigue. They say to the population, not just in Ukraine, this is not a Ukrainian problem, but they say to the population, you know what, your gas should be free. It came out of the soil. That soil is your Ukrainian soil. That gas is yours and it's free. They're charging you for that. Or, you know, we had 50% inflation. Your pension should have been increased 50%. That's great, but if anyone's ever had a macroeconomic course, you know, that's not going to work. But, you know, if you're an average Ukrainian citizen, it makes relative sense. Prices went up, my pension should have gone up. Yeah, that makes sense. And so they're selling this populist story to a population that's fatigued. And behind the populace often stands not the feeling of true communism or a different economic system, but those vested interests. Hiding behind the shoulders of people making open, blank promises like this. And those vested interests, I told you, you cut them off here, you took a bite out of their interests here, you hit them here, you hit them here, they're fighting back. They would in any environment. And so this is a tough battle for us. But I think the next US administration, tomorrow's the big day, has a major role to play in a global environment where I believe Ukraine has proven itself to be a very vibrant democracy. And it's proven that not because of some political will at the top, some officials who've made promises to other officials, but because the people of Ukraine have proven. They're giving their lives every day, not just during the revolution, but this war. They don't want to be part of the sphere of interests. They don't want to be part of a larger Russian Federation. They don't want to have that set of civil liberties. They want the civil liberties that they have. They know the difference. I remind you, Ukraine is one of the most tolerant countries from a religious perspective. We have the largest Mormon tabernacle east of Germany. You won't find that farther north. Every Protestant group on earth has a representation in Ukraine. We have synagogues, we have mosques, we have an all-faith church council that's made up of all of these faiths, and they all come together and they all speak in one language about the type of values and aspirations that they have for this country. And that's after a very mixed history in terms of both ethnic and religious relations. So this is remarkable progress. So US and our Western partners need to recognize that this is one of those situations where you've invested your taxpayer dollars for 25 years to create a democracy. You've done it for I don't know how many years in Afghanistan and Iraq. I don't know what the chances are of creating a democracy in Afghanistan and Iraq, but I guarantee you the probability in Ukraine is much greater because it's in the Ukrainian people's interest. And they're the ones pushing from below. They're the ones ensuring that if the top gets too tired or not strong enough, then they'll have another election. And they'll bring someone else in, and they're going to continue. And there's no better place in the world to prove that this democratic, liberal international order can, in fact, work than in Ukraine today, where the people of Ukraine want it. And so I recommend that the United States takes a role in helping us to fight the fatigue, the populism, and the vested interests, and puts together a consortium of some $25 billion over 5 years to invest in those things that the Ukrainian people will see and feel in their lives. Roads, hospitals, schools, e-government services that will eliminate corruption and will provide better services to the people of the country. We have to win over the hearts and minds of the people of Ukraine that will eliminate the populist argument. The vested interests won't be able to hide behind it, and we will win the reform process. And it has to be on a parallel track to the IMF. And of course, it has to be filled with conditionality. It has to have the medical reforms that are necessary to be able to put money into hospitals. It has to have the educational reforms that are necessary for a competitive education system if you're going to put money into schools. But instead of money, which is IMF program, that goes into the budget or the central bank reserves that the Ukrainian people don't feel, we need on a parallel track to do things in that part of the economy where the budget of Ukraine will not have the funds to do it on its own in the near future. And with that small investment of additional support for Ukraine, I think we can make this irreversible. I think we can make this a success for the whole region, and frankly speaking, we can ensure that Ukraine is part of a Europe that is whole, free, and at peace. The world is grappling with historic challenges today, and Ukraine is at the forefront of these challenges. The Kremlin's attempts to destroy Ukraine's European aspirations is simply one of its many challenges to the post-World War II international liberal order. The actions of the Kremlin, be them in Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova, in the US electoral process, in the funding of far-right, far-left parties throughout Europe, in Syria, in bombing hospitals in Aleppo, they have but one purpose: to destroy the transatlantic partnership and the principles of the post-World War II order and peace. Ukraine is simply one of the battlegrounds, the most important one to me, of course, and unity of our transatlantic partnership and of the democratic nations is absolutely critical. Unity of support for Ukraine, for Ukraine's transition process, is a critical part of this battle, because Ukraine's successful transformation is the key to all of Europe. Thank you very much. Thank you.
We're extremely impressed, amazed at all the work you've done. It's almost impossible to think that you've managed to do all of this in less than 2 years. No, and we noticed that you used the we, but still very inspiring. And now I'm sure that you have a lot of comments and questions. So we have two people who will be on either side of the aisle. If you can raise your hand toward them, and then they will bring you a microphone. And if you wouldn't mind also saying your name, or perhaps even standing up so that Ms. Jurescu can see you and know who you are. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. Thank you very much for your talk. My name is Eugene Bondarenko. I'm a lecturer in Ukrainian and Russian here at the University of Michigan. I have a question regarding the role of President Petro Poroshenko in the reforms. So I know that currently he is polling far behind, well, not far behind, but a significant amount behind the very populist threat that you've addressed. Well, at least in my opinion, she's a populist, who is Yulia Tymoshenko. He also, in conjunction with this poll, released a proposal to double the minimum wage, which, given the circumstances, sounds a lot like populism. First of all, what is your evaluation of Mr. Poroshenko's role in the reform process? Secondly, what is your what do you think the doubling the minimum wage, is that a realistic goal, or is that populism, or somewhere in between? Thank you very much.
The second question is extremely complicated. We spent, I don't know, half an hour on it earlier today. The first question is much simpler. President Poroshenko is the nationally elected president of the country. He was elected broadly across east, west, north, and south. He's been a wartime president with challenges that I can't even begin to describe to you. Again, for most Americans, war is something very far away on television. And for all of us, it's our neighbors, it's our sons, our fathers, our grandfathers, and it is extraordinarily difficult. We have a coalition in our parliament made up of two factions. One is his and one is the former prime minister's. Nothing happens in reforms in Ukraine without his support. So everything I've described had his support. Now, at times, we have more than that support, more than just the 226 from those two factions. Sometimes it crosses over. When I did the restructuring of the debt, I had to have it approved in the parliament, and we had over 300, I think we had 309 votes. So we crossed over into other factions at the time. But yes, his numbers and the numbers of any governing party, including the former prime minister, whose government I served, are very low. And that's a direct response, I believe, of two things. One is that fatigue that I described to you. And the second is the fact that Ukrainians have never really had great communications with regard to what is a reform. And the word reform in 25 years has become an ugly word. Reform is pain. And nobody explains to them that you can't get, you know, you can't cross the river without getting your feet wet, and that the reforms didn't mean pain when they finally were completed in Poland. Poland is one of the fastest growing economies, even through the most difficult times. Their economy's done quite well. And I spoke last night in Toronto with Mr. Leszek Balcerowicz, the father of Polish economic reform. And you know, it's a matter of how to now change the minds of Ukrainians, and that's why I raised doing something to win over their hearts and minds. I don't think we will be able to do a lot of educational reform, we can do some, or a lot of healthcare system reform without putting money into those, into the infrastructure. And so I think it becomes more and more difficult to tackle those reforms without some benefit coming sooner rather than later. I think that the president has, during the political crisis when I was in government, you know, led this process to a great extent, and there was broad political will to reform. Because when you're in a crisis, everyone wants to come out of it. Nobody wants to fall off the edge. Today, now that we've stabilized, it's like our success has been our Achilles heel. Because now that the economy's stable and we don't have to worry about import reserves and we don't have to worry about the currency fluctuation to the same degree, we're not safe, but nowhere near the danger zone that we were in. Today, political will across the board is weaker because there's not that feeling of economic crisis. With regard to the minimum wage, it's a very complicated issue because it's not only, you know, your hourly pay or in Ukraine, it's your monthly pay. Yeah. It's also tied to something called prожитковий мінімум, often, which is your minimum minimum living standard, and that defines typically pensions. It's also tied to something called the єдина тарифна сітка, or the single tariff structure, which is tied to the budget sector, teachers and doctors. And so until we see the exact details, I can't tell you what we can afford. What I can say is I've heard already that he's detaching it from the прожитковий мінімум. So increasing the minimum wage will not increase pensions directly. I've understood that they're also disconnecting it from the тарифна сітка, so it will not affect the budget sector overall. It might affect only the lowest level who are not yet receiving 3,200 hryvnia a month. So the primary purpose, and from a political standpoint, he's going to have to detach it from all government salaries. He's not going to be able to say it doesn't affect pensions and it doesn't affect teachers and doctors, but all government salaries are going up. So that's not going to happen, except the bottom, right? Unless you're being paid less than 3,200, but it shouldn't be a multiplier effect. And I think the key reason that he has introduced it, from his perspective, was to de-shadow the economy. We've been trying to get people to pay their salaries legally. One of the key reasons that it's important to pay your salaries legally is because the employer pays a payroll tax, social security tax. That's what funds our pension fund. And now, unlike many, many countries with demographic problems, the United States, Ukraine has the same, we have a huge pension fund deficit every year. And we had a very high payroll tax, which I halved, as part of the incentive to come out of the shadows, pay everyone legally. It didn't have that effect yet. I would argue that there wasn't enough time and there weren't enough policies around it to make it happen. And so he's trying to do it another way. And the logic, just for the average person in the audience, is the following. You pay the payroll tax on officially declared salary. So if you can't declare a salary that's less than a minimum wage, right now 1,600 hryvnia a month. So they pay 1,600 legally, they pay something else in cash. The cash part, they don't pay payroll taxes. So what he's basically trying to do is say, look, we know the consumer basket is around 3,200. People aren't living on $1,600. You must be paying them about $3,200. So I'm going to make it $3,200. You're going to pay payroll tax on $3,200 and stop paying in envelopes and cash. That's the general logic. The problem with that logic is that you can do a couple things. You can make them a part-time employee. How do people avoid providing health care in the United States? Part-time, work 38 hours, not 40. Again, this is not unique to Ukraine. Or you can do things like just take them off the records altogether. Reduce employment, pay them only cash. So alone, this policy is not going to deshadow. It would have to have other mechanisms, both PR, public advertising. There would have to be tax authorities going in and finding people who are cheating. You know, you have to have the carrot and the stick. And unless all of that happens, I don't think it's going to be a major deshadow. So in terms of how you can afford it, if they detach government, if they detach pension, if they detach the Yedina Tarifna Sitka, it should be affordable. But will it work? Don't know.
Hi, Nick Dechikiewski. Minister Yaresko, I just first want to really commend you in that after a political system kind of, in my view, slightly unfairly kind of spit you out, and yet you are here tirelessly promoting Ukraine and its reforms. So I want to thank you for that and commend you.
And you, for one,
would have the right to be tired, and you show us that you're not. Okay, so I appreciate it. A quick comment on, you know, the irreversibility, and we haven't reached it yet. I wonder if that's a construct that would work because, you know, it. I think a country might never get to that point. You know, a country could be overcome by populism, or reach a point that these things can be rolled back. But I know there's a point where it looks like it's going to be pretty stable. That leads me to what do you see in Ukraine as the effect of the European Union, which feels like it's unraveling, and in particularly those neighbors like Poland and Hungary, where we hear like the troubling signals that their democracies are being eroded. Is there a noticeable effect of that in Ukraine? And if so, what can be done? How important is that pull of the European Union, however weak it has been, on Ukraine's internal processes and its reform processes?
Well, thank you. Irreversibility for me isn't that you don't, you know, take two steps forward and one back, but that it doesn't necessarily all depend on individuals. And for me, rule of law is the key. You know, you need to have a system in place where it doesn't really matter the name of the tax inspector, whether he's your kum or your brother or your brother's cousin. It needs to be just a tax inspector, and that's because there's a general system of rule of law, and you have the same expectation no matter who he is and where he came from. That's the irreversibility. That doesn't mean that people aren't going to break the law, and it doesn't mean that there's going to be a tax inspector that doesn't overstep his bounds. That happens in every society, but it has to be the minority of the cases, not the majority, where we are today. And so that rule of law issue for me is critical for irreversibility. It doesn't mean that we're not going to have, you know, ups and downs. We will. The EU, it's a big question. There's a couple things happening. One is the EU is still a major draw for the Ukrainian people, because for the Ukrainian people sandwiched between two different systems of values, one to the north and one to the west, there's no other choice. And that became even more the case after the war. You know, Ukrainians became even more pro-European, pro-NATO, pro-transatlantic partnership after the war than they were before. They had been attacked. So Ukrainians tend to make fun of Europeans now and say, look, we died with your EU flags on our back, and you guys are saying you don't see the value in the European Union? You know, like, we're the most European of everyone. We value it more than you do. But it's not about membership. It's about values, principles, and a way of living. We have this deep and comprehensive free trade agreement, which defines in 270-some pages a variety of things we need to do. It's given us an open trading space, which is critical, with almost no tariffs, very few quotas. And that's enabled us to attract some businesses, for example, that are serving the East European corridor of automotive manufacturing with parts, wire harnesses, upholstery that's manufactured in Western Ukraine and on a just-in-time basis delivered inventory into the East European automotive corridor. Ukraine can be, and this agreement enables us, together with our own competitive labor force, both highly skilled and not terribly expensive at this point, to be the manufacturing platform for all of Europe. But we need to implement the agreement. That agreement is very complicated. It's everything from phytosanitary rules on chicken to hygiene rules to GMO rules. It's everything. It's everything. It's customs and everything. And that process is long and tedious, but it's moving forward. We have a deputy prime minister finally whose sole goal is to make sure that gets done. Again, I give the EU visa-free regime as an example. It was so important to the Ukrainian people that these 144 conditions were all adopted, and many of them were very difficult. This e-declaration system for that parliament, for this group of people, was extremely difficult. But they had no choice because the Ukrainian people wanted that visa-free regime. And no, which politician was going to stand up and say, you know what, we just can't do this e-declaration system. We don't want to tell you what we have in our safes and in our basements, and so we're not going to do EU visa. It just, there was no way to explain it. It had to get done. But it was one of 144. So the conditionality that comes from the EU, and then there's loans that have conditionality, is very important, and it does serve, I think, as a very positive tool to getting things done. But the EU generally is in its own transition and flummox. And for Ukraine, one of the most important issues is the continuation of sanctions against Russia for the illegal annexation of Crimea and for the invasion of Donbas. And the way the United States has sanctions is we put sanctions in place until such time as we decide to remove them. The EU does every 6 months a decision to add another 6 months. And every 6 months, 28 countries by consensus have to agree. And what's happened in the EU, Brexit, the Brits were big, staunch supporters of us with sanction, with the continuation of sanctions. The British voice is no longer there. You know, May is not even going to the next meeting, she's declared. Poland, one of our staunchest supporters, has, for its own reasons, the new government has challenged its own strength in the EU quarters because of some of the policies they've implemented at home. Because of Polish policies, they become less credible in the EU dialogue, or not maybe less credible, I should say less listened to. Their voice is not as strong. That leaves the Baltics, which is excellent, but they're very small countries, and they are very solidly behind Ukraine because they're living this along with us. You've seen the papers. You've seen the Estonian article this weekend on in New York Times about brigades practicing anti-invasion, and Lithuanians published a booklet for every household, what happens in case of invasion. But that said, you know, you also have countries in the southern rim, from Hungary to Italy, and you know, Prime Minister Renzi blocked sanctions against Russia with regard to Aleppo. And it wasn't even about Ukraine. So Europe is going through its own formative time. There's a lot of politics. You know, you have an election in Germany coming up. You have an election in France. You have an election. You have a referendum in Italy in December. You have an election in the Netherlands. We have the very difficult situation with migrants and the fear that Ukraine is somehow going to add to that problem. And so it's a very difficult time, I think, for the EU. But so far, the EU's been supportive. And so far, it looks like we should get our EU visa-free regime before the end of the year. Even though the Netherlands voted in a referendum not to ratify the EU agreement, it looks like they might have found a workaround, and it will be fully ratified and complete. This process could be complete by early next year. So, you know, I'm still very hopeful that the EU will continue its support, but I mean, Brussels has many of its own problems right now, and many of our supporters have lost the strength of their voice. So we need to step up. You know, that just means we need to be ever more active, and we need to be ever more clear about what we are doing right. We can't deny what we're doing wrong, and we can't deny the problems that we have. But the other side of the spectrum, they can't deny what we're doing correctly. They can't deny when we're making progress. When we fulfill our part of 144 conditions, they need to fulfill their side. You know, and now people are saying, well, we promised you EU visa-free before the migrant crisis. You know, if, God forbid, you know, the EU didn't fulfill its promises on EU visa-free, guarantee that those vested interests are going to go, why? We don't have to do e-declarations. Software just went down. Can't do it. you know, I mean, it wrecks it. So they've got to fulfill their side of their agreements.
Lada Prokop, I want to congratulate it for your work. All Ukrainians are very, very grateful to you. And thank you for such a lively talk that we thoroughly enjoyed. My question to you is, given that there are all these vested interests in Ukraine, I just read that Baltsun, the new CEO of the railway, said that the railways are completely controlled by mafia. So my question to you is, did you ever feel personally threatened while you were doing all these reforms?
So the short answer is no, I did not. I had a unique situation. I had been in the country for 25 years. I came into the country as a U.S. government official. I had a very... I had a U.S. passport, which is in and of itself, you know, a type of protection of some sort. I also had a reputation that preceded me into government when I was in business. I was very straight and narrow on the straight and narrow, and everyone knew that, so they didn't have to test me. So no one, people avoided asking me those kinds of things or trying to put any pressure on me. I was known to be very uncompromising, which may have been one of the reasons why they didn't invite, well, I can't, that's another, why I'm not there right now. I maybe don't make a good politician for that reason. I have to be honest, I mean, when they fought me in the parliament on policy in a, you know, in a normal voting fashion. So I never felt unsafe, personally. I never felt I was blessed in that respect. I was known as Minister No. My children even got me a red button that says no, and it says no five different ways, and go, no. And it was the joke. They'd come in, you know, in the budget season and say, you know, could we please have, and I'd say, no. But I had the support of the president, I had the support of the former prime minister, I had the support of the political environment at the time. You know, again, I was blessed, my timing was during this crisis when everyone wanted to fix the country. And so I was very lucky.
This is Oksana Poza, Ukrainian Women's League of America. Thank you for meeting with us earlier today. It was very pleasure to talk to you on a personal level, of course. My question is about this double whammy that Ukraine suffered with the loss of Donbass production. 20% of GDP, you said, was coming from there. That's lost. And then the massive flood of refugees, including professionals who had to leave their parts and move to Ukraine. So that's probably putting a drain on your budget too, because you have to support those people. So is there a program in place for resettling and reemployment of those massive human resources in Ukraine?
So both parts of it. On the GDP side, just to be clear, it was primarily heavy industry. And a lot of that heavy industry served our trade with the Russian Federation. A lot of that heavy industry has been stripped down to scrap metal and removed from the country. Cargill's sunflower oil processing plant in Donetsk has been reportedly mined, cannot be used. So I don't know how much of that economy is going to be restored when control over that territory is restored. You know, I would suspect that there are going to be factories that were not competitive. You know, as a legacy, you'd keep running them, but you wouldn't rebuild them. You know, just take steel, for example. You know, there's a glut in the steel market. China's capacities are overwhelming. Would you build a new steel plant in Ukraine? Probably not. So some of that's not going to be reappearing. Part of it was arms, and some of those have been physically moved, either one way or the other, depending on who got there first. either to one side of the board or the other. Part of it is coal. And the coal is important, not because Ukraine doesn't have other coal, we do, but it's a particular type of coal that's in the occupied territories. It's type D, and that it's the coal that we use in our thermal power plants. And now we have to import it either from the United States or from South Africa, which is expensive. The choices you have there in the short term are you can retool all your thermal power plants. That's money we don't have right now. Or you buy from South Africa, or you buy from the occupied territories, which has happened over the past few years. The other part is the human element, and the human element is much, much more difficult. We do have a subsidy program for our internally displaced people, but it's tiny. We don't have a proper resettling. This is the strength again. This the positive part of this is the strength of Ukrainian society, which is welcomed into their homes. Basically, these 2 million people. People go to their friends, their relatives. They live for a few months here. They live for a few months there until they get up back on their feet. There are some settlements. The German government has helped us with building some temporary housing, so it's not 100% like that. But the great bulk of it is the support has been provided in a non-formal way by society itself. In Kharkiv, in Dnipropetrovsk, in Kyiv, Zhytomyr, Crimean Tatars, to a large extent, have gone to Lviv, which is, you know, a wonderful thing. But the reconciliation process that will have to happen on the human side once we return the territory to our sovereignty is going to be enormous. It's going to be enormous. You've had brother against brother. You've had a complete shutdown of any media or information from the Ukrainian side into that occupied territory. Only the propaganda coming from the terrorists and from the Russian Federation. It's going to be a long process, and we're going to need. We have a new ministry focused simply on this these challenges, but we're going to need to probably seek out help from other countries that have been through this process. Use best practices to try and make this as painless as possible. But it's going to require money that doesn't exist in the budget, and it's going to require psychological support, job support. It's going to be broad. We did a good job in resettling the students from the universities. We took Donetsk University and co-located it with Vinnytsia University. So with the university students, we did a good organized job. But in other areas, I can't say we've done as well. So I think we still have an enormous amount to do to satisfy that challenge. We were not ready. We just weren't ready.
Roman Hrecio, I'm a professor of engineering here, but I also work with civic organizations in Ukraine. And thank you so much. I'll add my voice to those who are thanking you, and particularly for being part of a rare example of the reverse brain drain for Ukraine and being one of those that has done so much having not been born in Ukraine. Ukraine loses probably 20,000 people for every one that comes back. And there was something that you said in your presentation that was disheartening, and that there is not going to be the strength to reform the educational system at this time. And my question is, can Ukraine afford not to reform the educational system, given that in every example where investments are made in educational systems, the return on investment are tremendous worldwide? Tell us something hopeful about the educational system.
So I don't want you to take it out of context. I didn't mean do nothing. Minister Hrinavich, her colleague prior to her, Minister Kvit, have done quite a bit in trying to reform at the university level, now at the basic primary school level. So I'm not saying that nothing will happen. But it's happening at a very gradual basis. I mean, schools are part of the most conservative part of any society. And, you know, if you want to shut down, for example, schools that have under 20 children, it's the right thing to do for education. Because with under 20 children at different ages, you're not getting specialist teachers. You know, they're all in one classroom. They're not getting the equivalent education as in the town next door where there are, you know, 8 grades or 7 grades. So I just know, for example, on that, you know, to bus somebody's children, we've had this in our own, to bus somebody's children to the next town, well, you need a bus. You need roads. It's typically in the mountain areas. And you need to convince the parents that the kids are going to get a better education. So you need to create these hub schools, basically. And different, Moldova's done it successfully. Ireland's done these hub schools successfully. But hub schools means you got to, you know, you've got to tell the parents that they've got a better science lab and a better computer lab, and they've got, you know, better windows and better roofs, and that they have a better English language teaching program, and that requires money. And so what I'm describing to you is it'll be easier for us to close the schools with under 20 kids if we can offer, you know, 450 hub schools. Now, I was able to find, right before I left, enough funding to do 24 hub schools, one in every oblast. Yeah. but, you know, that was, it has like an example effect. But one hub school and having hub schools for all the kids is not the same. And so that reform is going to be much harder to do, even though it's fiscally necessary, and it's also from an education standpoint necessary. It's even, I think, in the IMF program. So I'm not suggesting they'll do nothing. I actually believe you're absolutely right. It's probably critical. The world is moving at a pace where Ukraine can either leapfrog and catch up or even excel in certain areas. We excel in engineering, we excel in mathematics and physics, we excel. Now we need to apply that in the way that the world applies it. Our Academy of Sciences, the knowledge in our Academy of Sciences is incredible. However, the way it's organized, the way it's financed, the way it's the age of the average Academy of Sciences doesn't enable it to compete where it should be in the world. And so the reform of the Academy of Sciences, which is something I tried to do with fiscal policy very hard, it needs focus, it needs energy. Ukraine cannot succeed in this competitive world without education reform. So I'm not suggesting it can't be done or they're not trying to do it. All I'm saying is it's a very conservative area. And, you know, having some physical benefit to parents would help with that story. If it's only about difficult things, it's, you know, closing hospitals, we had this discussion today. We have too many hospitals per capita. But any hospital you close is nurses, it's doctors. And if you're not providing something of positive value somewhere else, all you hear about is the closing and the people who don't have a job or are, you know, I mean, unemployment is still a practical issue in Ukraine. So to do these things, you know, if you could provide telemedicine in the hospital next door, right? Or, you know, proper mammogram machines or whatever the case may be, and you can tell the population, we close this, but this one is now twice as good. But, you know, just closing it, which is, again, as a finance ministry, I could say, you know, it's probably the right thing to do. It's not being used, empty beds, but still, it makes it too hard.
We have time for one last question.
Yours.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Paul Zaitsu, and I wanted to thank you for being here. It's a real pleasure. We need more of this kind of conversation. I have many ideas going through my head, and one of the main reasons I came here is not just because I'm involved in business. I've been a banker for 30 years. Similar to what you're doing, I know how capital is raised. I understand a little bit about the process. Money is very important. Finances are very important. We have a great group of very brilliant people here in the United States and in Canada. A lot of medical people, a lot of lawyers. We have a lot of great business people here as well. You said something that hit my nerve. You said you need to step up. You've stepped up. How do we, tell us how we step up here. I'm busy. I'm raising a family. I'm traveling. I'm working. But I have a real desire to make a difference. Is there a centralized place? You have these great think tanks, but they're in Boston. They're in New York. And we're very splintered as a Ukrainian group between Orthodox and Catholics and speaking Ukrainian, non-speaking Ukrainian. But we all have one common goal. How do you get us all together so that we can fight with you and so that we can make a difference politically? We've got two people right now that are running, and one has a Russian friend, and we don't know exactly the difference that they're going to make. How do we get involved?
So first of all, thank you for wanting to be involved. I think there are literally thousands of ways that people who want to help Ukraine, whether you're Ukrainian or not, can help Ukraine. And I'm not, because I don't believe in central command and all that, I mean, I don't know that we'll ever find a way to organize everyone who wants to help. And so I think you need to find like-minded people and organize amongst yourselves in that respect. But I would start with the American political process. You know, I will tell you the number of times I reached out and said, call every day. When we were fighting to get defensive weapons, when we were under major attack, I know you're busy, I know everyone has a life, but I also know that it takes less than 7 minutes to log in a phone call to the White House. And if you call once a day, it's the same as having your cup of coffee in the morning. You leave your name, your demand, and every single person that you know does the same thing. That would have had a major effect on the White House's thinking. Now, some Ukrainian Americans did do it. Some think tanks did it. But it wasn't done every day for 3 months, nonstop. Your two senators, your representative, four phone calls, every day. It's that simple. We could have made a difference. Other communities do that when they need the White House to act. Our community didn't do that. Not in those numbers, not in that regularity, not with that absolute command of, we want defensive weapons. Take another example. When over the summer I happened to be trying to rest after having a very difficult couple of years, and one of the presidential candidates came out and said, you know, Crimea probably is better off. I don't remember the exact quote, but something like as part of Russia or something, or it was always or something. It's just a factually incorrect statement, because the UN General Assembly has overwhelmingly voted that this is the illegal annexation of Crimea. So whatever he may personally think as a person running for office, he made a factual error. 2 + 2 = 3. Crimea is not Russia. Now, I don't want to get into US politics, but every American, Ukrainian American, should have been calling both their senators, the House, and that candidate as well, and saying, please correct the factual pattern. I'm not even talking, you don't even have to use his name. Crimea is not Russia. Crimea was illegally annexed, period. I did it. I sat on vacation in Italy, and I wrote 100 tweets to congressmen, senators, the president, the candidates. So 100 times over, I will tell you to engage in the American political process. You're closest to it. They listen to you. It has an effect, number one. Number two, there are all kinds of ways to help Ukraine. If your area of expertise is education, look for partners in the educational process. Last night I was in Toronto supporting the Ukrainian Catholic University. Ukrainian Catholic University is rolling out some programs on rehabilitative medicine for our veterans. So if you're in the medical field, they're rolling out, they have a new center for leadership in their business school. They need people to come and teach a course. They need people to come and provide scholarships to students. The scholarship for a year for a student is $3,000. It's not Yale tuition, my daughter. If you support education, support education. If you support medical, there are ways to support medical. You could do so much with human-to-human contacts. I sat yesterday with the head of the Ukrainian-Canadian Congress, and I'd suggest that the United States Congressional Committee, UKCA, can do similar things in terms of organizing if they'd like. But I mean, you know how you have sister city pairings. But you know, if every parish, and you said we have Orthodox, we have Catholic, we have Pentecostal, we have Baptist, we have much more than that in the United States. If every single parish picked another parish in the middle of nowhere somewhere, not Kiev, not Lviv, not St. George's, which is dripping in gold. I'm talking about, you know, regular towns. My parish in Bloomingdale, Illinois, did this in Baturin. Deepest, darkest Baturin, which had been destroyed. There was no Kiev Patriarchate church there, no Greek Catholic church there. We built a church, but it's not about the money. More importantly, as we created a children's center in the basement, we took the kids off the streets. We helped them organize PLAST, Ukrainian scouting, specifically for the boys who end up drinking alcohol too early, at an early age when there's nothing to do in these towns. We provided them with all kinds of programs. We hooked them up to the internet. We gave them 2 computers. It could be old computers from your business. They have a little newsletter with their parish. Our parish does a little newsletter. They do little events at Christmas together. They have these kids in the middle of what was, it's not anymore, deepest, darkest northeastern Ukraine. But it is the eastern border and a very important historic town. These kids now have an outlet to the United States with other kids. and the kids in the Ukrainian schools. The kids in the Ukrainian schools, how many times after church or whatever, or your Ukrainian school, how many Saturdays or Sundays in a row have you sat down with a table and written letters to the veterans, or to the boys on the front? Do you have any idea how much it means to them? I'm not even talking about money, because I know everyone's tired of giving money. I'm trying to describe things so you can do at no cost. Have you, you know, have someone help you write letters to the prisoners that have been taken by the Kremlin, the Crimeans who are being killed in their cells. Getting letters from you, you can't imagine what that means. There are ways to help Ukraine, from teaching to participating in business contacts to establishing sister cities if you haven't gotten one already. US-Ukraine Foundation in Washington does a lot of the sister cities work if that's what you're interested in. Others do other things. Everyone has their specialty. It's never going to be centrally organized, but there are thousands of ways. We in the diaspora, we tend to go through peaks and valleys. We get interested for a few days, and then we go back to our lives. But set your clock every day. You know, set your clock for a phone call to the White House. There's going to be a new White House. I don't care. You know, I do care. But no matter who's in the White House, start making those calls right after the inaugural. Ukraine needs to be on the agenda. Ukraine's success is Europe's success. Europe's success is the success of the democratic world. Ukraine is defending Europe. Simple statements, but just make your call. Make it once a week. You can't do it every day, make it once a week. Make 3 phone calls a week, not 3 phone calls a day. I think that we need to be consistent. We need to be demanding. You know, here's an easy one. Tourism. Bring your tourism dollars to Ukraine. Some of you may have come earlier in the 90s and it was dark and it was post-Soviet and it wasn't that fun. Today, Lviv is a burgeoning, beautiful city. I took my daughter to Prague, and my daughter said, you know, Mom, I don't want to go back. I'd rather go to Lviv. Lviv is nicer than Prague. It's more fun. Kamianets Podilsky, which is an historic fortress built by everyone, Lithuanians, Poles, everyone had a little hand in it, has turned into an artsy little town, a wonderful place. The Carpathians, both in winter and in summer, now offer sports tourism of a very high quality. Skiing in the winter, kayaking, whitewater rafting, you name it in the summer. Plus you get the cultural aspect. And there are hotels now, and there are cars now, and recently there are even roads. Now, I'm not suggesting you take every vacation every year, but one family vacation every once in a while, put your tourism dollars into Ukraine. It creates jobs. So it doesn't even have to be hard work. You can enjoy yourself doing it. I recommend everyone try.
Thank you so much. Thank you for coming.